American Sports Cavalcade. A panorama of speed, color, drama, and excitement. The American Sports Cavalcade.
This is Madison, Indiana, nestled on the banks of the Ohio River. In 1951, the Thunderboats came here for the first sanctioned Madison regatta, called the Indiana Governor's Cup. The winner that year was Marion Cooper in a boat called the Hornet. A lot has changed during that time, but at least one thing has remained the same. It's fast, it's exciting. The unlimited hydroplanes competing for the Indiana Governor's Cup. I'm Ed Bruce. Madison is one of the oldest sites on the national powerboat racing circuit. In 1967, they shortened this three-mile course to 2.5 miles. There's very long straights and very tight turns. And over the years, it's proved quite a challenge to powerboat racers. Powerboat racing is unique in motorsports. These boats, powered by a variety of engines, can do 180 miles an hour in the straights before power sliding into a turn. Right now, my partners Brock Yates and Steve Evans are by the river waiting to call the action for you.
Ed, the big news so far here at Madison is a war between two totally different types of aircraft power plants, one from the 1940s and one far more contemporary. The fastest qualifier is Chip Hanauer in the Miller American boat, powered by a current model Chinook helicopter turbine that makes over 3,700 horsepower. The number two qualifier is this boat, Miss 711, driven by Steve Reynolds. Now, this is a Vietnam-era turbine that makes about 2,600 horsepower. The Miller boat, that engine will be outlawed at the end of the season, just too much power. This boat will be legal for the foreseeable future. Now, for years, they've called these thunderboats. In the case of the turbines, they're more like whisper boats. For the real thunder, let's go to Brock Yates.
And Steve, this is the source of that thunder. These are the engines that have made unlimited powerboat racing the great sport that it is today. Rolls-Royce Merlin engines, vintage World War II, as you said, first seen in Mustang P-51 fighter planes, now used in powerboat racing with great effectiveness. They're from Scott Pierce's Executone boat, currently leading the point series in the Thunderboats. They are 1,650 cubic inch motors, generate about 3,000 horsepower. Not quite as much as your turbines, but I'll tell you what, in terms of tradition, competitiveness, and thunder, they can't be beat.
Let's take a look at the boats we'll be seeing today and how they qualified. The slowest qualifier, the U-22 boat called Cellular One. This is owned by Jim Sedan and driven by Todd Yarling from Hanover, Indiana.
Well, Steve, we've got the Oh Boy Alberto. That's a sausage company out of Seattle, Washington. It's an old boat built way back in 1974. That is powered by an Allison engine, turbocharged, driven by Jerry Hopp out of Snohomish, Washington.
Well, the oldest boat in the field, the conventional engine configuration in front of the driver, the Miss Madison U6, that is driven by Andy Coker of West Palm Beach, Florida. It may be the oldest, but certainly not the slowest at 112.2 miles per hour.
Okay, Miss Executone is another Seattle boat. That's powered by one of those Rolls-Royce Merlin engines, 3,000 horsepower. Scott Pierce, 38-year-old driver from Seattle, Washington, one of the veterans in this business.
And a Rolls-Royce Griffin motor powers the most famous name in unlimited racing, Bernie Little's Miss Budweiser U1, the defending national champion, driven by Jim Kropfeld of Cincinnati, Ohio, 130 miles per hour.
And this is one of those turbine boats you were talking about, Steve. This is the Miss 711, again out of that northwestern part of the country, Seattle, Washington. Steve Reynolds, a veteran in this business, from Kirkland, Washington, at the wheel.
This is the boat to beat, the Miss Miller American, driven by Chip Hanauer, the first boat ever to top 140 miles an hour on this 2.5 mile Madison course, turbine powered, of course. The racing format is similar to circle track auto racing. A series of preliminary heats qualify the boats for an all-out final. Now, in Heat 1A coming up, we'll be seeing Jerry Hopp of the Miss Old Boy Alberto Boat U4, Jim Kropfeld of the Miss Budweiser, Todd Yarling in Cellular One, and Andy Coker in the vintage Miss Madison. You would expect the Miss Budweiser boat to be the class of the field in Heat 1A. Maybe it is, but really this is an interim boat. Their turbine boat with the enclosed cockpit that has received so much publicity had some problems, a fire as a matter of fact, and it's being repaired. So this is really kind of a stopgap boat out here trying to get as many points as they possibly can. Earlier, Brock Yates had a chance to examine the cockpit of the Miss Budweiser boat. It is something to see.
If you ever peeked inside a race car cockpit, you'll remember that it doesn't have very many instruments. Maybe a tachometer, oil pressure gauge, water temperature gauge, and that's about it. Not so with an unlimited hydroplane. Take a look at this complexity here on Jim Kropfel's instrument panel. Right up here, airspeed indicator, just like on an aircraft. Down here, this is a miles per hour through the water, but Jim primarily pays attention to the airspeed because this thing is really more like an airplane at speed than it is a boat. This is his oil pressure warning light, really important. If he starts, sees that thing flashing, he knows he's got some oil pressure problems, so we'll slow it down. This is the tachometer. Notice about 4,000 RPMs. That's a lot more than this engine ever ran in an airplane. This big Griffin engine that powers this boat is very, very strong engine, and he will run it up to about 4,000 RPMs, and by the way, get about 4,000 horsepower. This is a starting watch. Remember, these guys start against a clock, and Jim also carries a similar watch on his wrist. This is a warning light for an emergency on the course. The chief starter throws a switch at the starting stand, and all the boats carry this switch or this little light, and it throws on, and Jim will slow down. This is the manifold pressure, just like in an airplane. This is oil pressure. This is the manifold temperature gauge, which is very important. If Jim sees this needle getting up into the red area, he knows he's in danger of burning a piston, and he'll just have to back the boat down. A variety of other instruments down here, on-off switch over here, and these four buttons on the steering wheel, very important. Those are the nitrous oxide buttons. Jim can punch any one of these wherever his hand position is on the wheel, and it'll give him a burst of power, maybe about 500 extra horsepower coming off the corner. So that's an extra little bit of power that he's got. Can't use it for very long, or else he will burn a piston, but it's there as a little emergency tactic for big boost, big acceleration. So lots there to do. You don't just sit in one of these big brutes and kind of steer it around the course. As you can see, there's a lot to do, a lot to pay attention to on the instrument panel.
Well, Brock, now I know why so many of these drivers are also licensed pilots. Just about have to be. Jim Kropfel warming up the Miss Budweiser in preparation for Heat 1A. Stay with us.
Getting ready for the start of Heat 1A of the Budweiser Indiana Governor's Cup here in Madison, Indiana. And Steve Evans, the start is kind of tricky in one of these unlimited races.
And it has to be timed perfectly, Brock. The boats go into the water with 5 minutes on the clock. It is now down to 16, 15 seconds. They cannot cross the starting line before the time is down to zero. Now, this is a ragged start. Todd Yarling is clear out on the backstretch somewhere. Andy Coker in the Miss Madison boat, not even close. It looks like Jerry Hopp, the Miss Oh Boy Alberto, is going to have the advantage on the start. On the inside, on the outside, comes Miss Budweiser Jim Kropfel.
And look at that big Rolls-Royce tripping in Kropfel's boat. Just suck in Jerry Hopp as they go down into turn number one. Jerry Hopp on the inside, but that big, strong boat of Kropfel is going right around him on the outside.
And this is where they use that nitrous in the turns to launch him out of the turn, actually. And this is some pretty rough water, especially down in turn number two.
Well, we've got a two-boat race here right now. As you said, Coker and Yarling way back. Yarling's watch must have stopped or something on that start, because he was on the back straight, and as we said earlier, those guys have watches on board to back time toward the start. There goes Jerry Hopp trying to hold off Kropfel, but it isn't going to work. That's the back straight going down the Ohio River toward turn number three.
Well, Jim Kropfel with the Miss Budweiser boat certainly has an advantage here, but you wonder, Jerry Hopp has the shortest way around this course with that inside line. If that boat will corner properly, he may make it up coming into this next buoy.
Well, it's interesting the contrast in these two boats. Of course, Kropfel with an almost 4,000 horsepower Griffin engine in his, and Jerry Hopp with an older turbocharged Allison developing maybe 2,300 horsepower, so he's way down on power. But as you can see, he tucked inside, stayed right in close to those buoys, and managed to get out in front of Kropfel coming off that turn number four. But here comes Kropfel with all that horsepower. These boats are heavy too, Steve. These are both about 7,000 pound boats, quite a bit heavier than the modern boats. But Kropfel's boat having to carry all the weight because of that big, big Griffin engine that he's got on board.
Well, Kropfel obviously has a lot of confidence in his boat and in his power plant, because he's taking a very wide line, literally letting Jerry Hopp make up some of that advantage.
Well, don't forget, the secret in one of these races is to finish. And if you hurt the boat with too much
much nitrous or abuse it too hard, then you're not going to go on and advance into the more into the future. So Kropfeldt, I'm sure, reckons that he can hold off Hop, and maybe he's just kind of easing it around a little bit just to save that motor. But Hop, boy, he's not giving up at all. He's got that old turbocharged Allison working real hard, and in fact nosed a little bit in front of Kropfeldt going down the back straight. But here comes Jim, and it looks as if he's going to start to carve out a bigger lead.
These hydroplanes reach their top speed down the straightaway, Brock. There's very little of the boat in the water. Really just the skid fin and the propeller.
And they call them unlimited hydroplanes, and that's exactly what they are. They're really a rudimentary rules. They have to be at least 28 feet long and have to have a propeller to drive them through the water. Other than that, anything goes, really.
Well, the scenario remains the same here. Jerry Hop catches up in the turns and then loses it on the straightaway. There goes Miss Budweiser. Jim Kropfeldt is far more power.
Very clear that he's got a big advantage, and I'll tell you what, that is one of the sweetest sounding internal combustion engines you'll ever hear. Big, root supercharged aircraft engine dating from very late in World War II. Probably the most advanced gasoline-powered aircraft engine ever built.
Now, I don't know if Kropfeldt is taking it easy on the Miss Bud boat or what, but look at Jerry Hop. Suddenly down the straightaway, he takes the lead.
Well, there's Andy Coker still riding in third place. That, of course, is what they call an old conventional boat, front engine, versus the rear engine boats, more modern boats. But Andy Coker giving it a good ride. He had a bad start, as did Todd Yarling, and is well back right now.
Well, a heck of a fight for the lead. Miss Budweiser, Jim Kropfeldt on the outside. You see it right here, the U-1 boat. And on the inside, right alongside him, Jerry Hop, Miss Old Boy Alberto, putting up a stronger fight than anybody thought.
Well, Jim Kropfeldt, of course, the reigning national champion in unlimited hydroplanes, came into the sport like a demon, won 10 of his first 22 races, Steve, the best starting record of any rookie ever in the history of this sport. Brilliant driver, Cincinnati, Ohio, spent a long time in the lower classes of hydroplane racing, and then finally got his big break with this Miss Budweiser team a couple of years ago.
Well, they have scored 7 national titles in Thunderboat racing. Jerry Hop still hoping for his first. He is a licensed pilot, as I commented earlier, so many of them are.
And works on the crew of this old boy, Alberto, all on a full-time basis. And there it goes. There you can see the speed of that Miss Budweiser, probably pushing 180 miles an hour here down these long straightaways on the Madison course.
Of course, these are all the internal combustion engines in this Heat 1A. We're yet to see the muscle of the turbine boats, either the Miss 711 or the Miller American. And those certainly are the boats the crowd has come to see here this weekend.
So the race continues for first with Jerry Hop not about to give up and gaining all that advantage on that inside. You can see him right up against those buoys as Kropfeldt has to take the long way around. And these boats, by the way, are very, very treacherous in another boat's wake, Steve. So you can't really cross a wake or else you're going to dump one upside down. So as you can see, Kropfeldt probably would be like to be on that inside line. That's the short way around, obviously, but he can't do it. So he has to stay out side and just rely on this Budweiser's awesome power to stay in front.
You're right, Brock. You're pretty well obligated to maintain a certain line once you take it. In fact, there are unlimited officials hovering in a helicopter over the course to make sure there are no driving fouls. It's not like sprint car racing. You just can't play bump and run and cutting guys off in the turns. It's just too dangerous.
No Nerf bars on these babies. They are very sensitive boats. And, of course, a little indiscretion can put one upside down. As we watch Todd Yarling, he's still back there in fourth place due to that bad start he had. Miscalculation, to be sure. But that boat is a strong boat, and I'm sure his object right now is simply to finish so he can go on to one of the more advanced heats.
Well, Seattle resident Jerry Hop, the U4 Miss O'Boy Alberto, in second place right now. The boat sponsored by the Sausage Company. And he'll be content to stay there, Brock, as you said, to finish, get those points.
All right, that's the big flag from the official stand. That says one more lap. And the drivers have to rely on, just like on a regular automobile race, for that flag signal. That tells them that there's only 2.5 miles left in this particular heat. And there goes Jim Kropfeldt, now starting to pull out a substantial lead. He kind of left Jerry on that last lap, and Pierce headed for a victory, but anything can happen. These boats are hardly the most reliable machines on Earth. Very complicated, and who's going to know anything can break near the end?
And you got to have a lot of admiration for Andy Coker in the Miss Madison boat. What a pounding he takes. Not not to mention that, with the engine location, as you see it here, he's the first to know if anything goes wrong. He gets the oil, the fire, and oh, man, he's got to be sore, Brock, when he gets out of that boat.
That's like riding a cement mixer out there. I just can't imagine any seat that would be less comfortable than that particular one that Andy Coker's got. You can see those big turbocharger stacks, exhaust stacks coming out there, and they're just about a bright in his face. But Andy Coker hangs in there. He's got himself a third spot here in this heat if he can come around to finish. So Andy Coker heads down the back straightaway here on the Madison course. As you can see, the Ohio River's starting to get a little bit choppy.
But that doesn't affect Jim Cropville. He takes the win in heat 1A. The crew showing their appreciation to the Miss Budweiser boat and its fine driver. But suddenly, Brock, we've got a pretty good duel going for third place in heat 1A. The Miss Madison boat on the outside, and here you see coming through on the inside, recovering from that bad start, Todd Yarling in the Cellular One.
Yeah, he's been steadily making up distance on Andy Coker, and it's going to be interesting to see whether Todd Yarling can run him down. It doesn't look like that's going to happen, because I think Andy Coker's got enough straightaway speed to carry on to finish third overall. So Todd Yarling can't make up the distance after his bad start, and Andy Coker comes home to the delight, as you said, of the Madison fans. This is a hometown boat, and across the finish line he comes, riding it out. And right behind him, Todd Yarling, almost making up the distance, but still finishing in the scratch spot back and forth. The winner, Jim Cropville, taking second. Jerry Hoff and the old boy Alberto, Coker and Yarling rounding out the four-boat field. We'll be back with more from the Budweiser Indiana Governor's Cup from Madison, Indiana, following this.
How important to this community is the Indiana Governor's Cup race? Well, the Coast Guard cooperates by stopping barge traffic on the river, but it certainly doesn't stop pleasure boats from coming both ways up the Ohio to see this beautiful community and this exciting event. I'm Steve Evans, along with Brock Yates and Ed Bruce. We've just completed Heat 1A, and Jim Cropville won it in the Miss Budweiser boat. He is coming back to the dock right now.
And I'm sure it was a popular victory with the over 50,000 fans who lined the shore here at Madison, as we watch Jim conferring with one of the crewmen about perhaps something that he noticed going wrong with that boat. Be interesting to see what they do in terms of maintenance between the heats. Okay, there is the point standings as of now, and of course that's based purely on the results of the first heat, Steve. But you notice that Budweiser now has a 400-point lead. He got a 100-point edge over Jerry Hoff, which isn't all that much.
And only four boats are going to make the final, Brock, out of the seven that have qualified. So there's nothing diminutive about this sport, is there? It takes cranes to get the boats out of the water. You deal in great big flags, great big clocks, and there's just nothing small, except maybe the all-important watch you see here on the wrist of Chip Hanauer. Chip getting that yacht racing watch adjusted just right so that it is in sync with the official timers when that five-minute gun goes off. And we saw how disastrous a bad start can be for Todd Yarling in Heat 1A. Chip Hanauer not about to let that happen to him. In fact, the drivers take great pride in their starts, much like a drag racer would that can cut a good light on a drag strip. They have to be right at that starting line as that final gun goes off. So Chip Hanauer slipping on his helmet, getting ready for Heat 1B. Well, the winner of Heat 1A, as we saw, was Jim Cropville of the Miss Budweiser boat. He is finally back on the dock, and with him is Brock Yates.
Oh, Jim, good job. Good start, huh?
Well, a little late on the start, but the water was so rough that I needed a couple more seconds than I anticipated for my timing runs.
Well, you kind of ran with Jerry for a while and then just kind of eased it out and let that big Griffin start to work for you.
Well, I was running about as hard as I wanted to go there for a while, and then Jerry started slowing down a little bit.
Uh-huh.
And to keep up on top of that rough water, I have to run a little faster than we did about that third lap, so I thought I better go ahead a little more, and it was just beating the heck out of me. It tears up the equipment, too, when you pound that hard. So I had to get some air under it, and the only way to do that is go faster.
I tell you what, there are about 50,000 people that just loved it for the first couple of laps.
Well, I hope they did. You know, that's how they paid their money. We hope they really enjoyed it.
Well, that's great. We'll see you later.
Okay, thank you.
So as Jim starts to confer with boat owner Bernie Little, let's go to Steve Evans with the second-place finisher in Heat 1A, Jerry Hoff.
I'll tell you, we had the Hop and the Crop show there for a couple of laps. A good first heat.
Somebody called it the Jim and Jerry show. I don't know. It sounded good to me. Well, I was pretty close on the start. I could have been a little closer, but I was first one, so I guess that's what counts.
Well, it feels good to lead, especially ahead of a renowned boat like that.
Yeah, it's awful rough on that backstretch over there. I'm sure you can see the boats bouncing out of the water and the rooster tails going up and down. And whenever you see the rooster tails dropping up and down like that, that water's real rough. There's some real big swells rolling down that backstretch.
Physically, what's the most punished part of your body? Arms, shoulders, neck, what?
The brain. I don't know. I know, it's just, this suit is so hot, you know, that it, out there you don't feel it because the air's going by you. But, boy, as soon as you get done, I think my arms are probably the most tired from hanging on with all the bouncing.
What a ride it must be. As we watch the Miller American turbine boat being lowered into the water, remember we had a look at the maze of instruments inside Miss Budweiser? Well, earlier, Steve had a look at this boat's interior.
Well, the cockpit of the Chip Hanauer-driven Miller American may not be that of a 747, but it's still plenty complicated from a racing machine standpoint. Let's take a look. First of all, the tachometer, which is right here, will read much higher than a piston engine, obviously. It's about 15,000 RPMs, even though the prop turn's about 12. They have to underdrive the propeller. Now, this bank of lights here looks very much like today's computerized talking cars. And just like your car, the best news of all is no news. You don't want any of those lights on whatsoever. Now, Chip is also belted into this boat. The old conventional boats like the Miss Madison, they were really designed to throw the driver out intentionally. Chip was the first to come along with safety belts, much like a NASCAR or a drag racer might carry. He also sits very low and very tight in the boat. In fact, so low they had to put indicators out on the sponson so that Chip knew where the boat was.
Well, you hear that whistle. That is the sound of turbine power, raw horsepower, raw jet horsepower, as Chip Hanauer gets ready to get underway with the Miller American turbine-powered boat. That's over 3,000 horsepower in that Jim Lucero-designed hull. Perhaps the most advanced unlimited hydroplane in the world, Steve Evans.
And in this heat, he will be facing the other turbine, the Miss 711, driven by Steve Reynolds. You see it here warming up. Now, these two drivers would rather this confrontation came in the final this afternoon, but the way they qualified, they meet each other in Heat 1B.
And that's a three-boat confrontation. Scott Pierce and the beautiful Merlin-powered Executron versus the two turbine boats, a Hanauer and Reynolds. Stay with us. We'll be back from Madison.
Well, they're still warming up here in Madison, Indiana for the Budweiser Indiana Governor's Cup Heat 1B. Of course, this is a battle between the Titan Turbines, the Miss 711 boat, and the Miller American, and also the series leading boat, Executone, driven by Scott Pierce. But first of all, back in the pit area, a spare power plant being installed in the Miss Budweiser, Brock.
Well, that's a pretty routine thing between heats, Steve, but as you know, they've got a monopoly on these Rolls-Royce Griffin engines, but it's going to be a rarer and rarer sight because the Budweiser team is going to convert to turbine power like Miller American in the 711. In fact, they've got a turbine-powered boat that was tested earlier this season. Notice that Kropfeldt is in a fully enclosed cockpit, oxygen on board, just like a fighter plane.
But if you watch closely in this test footage from Seattle, you'll see why that turbine boat is not with us in Indiana. As Kropfeldt leaves it, suddenly, a tremendous explosion did a lot of damage to the boat. They're unable to repair it, and also before they even repair it, they want to find out exactly why it happened. So they will rely here in Indiana on the trustworthy piston engines.
Which, by the way, has more horsepower in raw terms than the turbines. But as we watch the Heat 1B boats getting ready to come down for the start, got 19 seconds to go, the Kropfeldt engine change continues. And that is the turbine-powered boat of Steve Reynolds. And it looks like he's going to nail the start right to the split second, Steve.
Well, you can bet he's watching that big clock up on the bank, because if he crosses that starting line before the time evaporates, he'll be disqualified. Boy, he did. A beautiful start. That is the Miss 711 boat, Steve Reynolds, on the inside. On the outside is the Miller American, Chip Hanauer. Remember, that is a bigger turbine. It has more horsepower. And you're starting to see that horsepower pay off. Even though he's on the outside, he is slipping and sliding through turn number two and making up ground on Steve Reynolds.
Well, you can see those boats broad sliding just like dirt track cars as they come through that big, wide, sweeping turn. Now, down the back straightaway, Steve Reynolds still holding on to a little bit of a lead on the inside. But let's see whether Hanauer can make up the distance with that lighter and somewhat more powerful boat ahead.
And Brock Reynolds' boat looks to be trimmed out perfectly, handling beautifully, and he's got the inside line he wanted, the shortest way around this 2.5 mile course, knowing that the horsepower advantage goes to Chip Hanauer, who is on the outside somewhere behind that rooster tail of water. There he is, Hanauer, hammer down, coming out of turn number four.
Well, you're seeing two of the most advanced boats in all the world competing against each other. That boat of Jim Lucero, driven by Chip Hanauer, certainly the most modern of them all. Steve Reynolds' boat about 3 years old, but look at this. Hanauer just blowing by Reynolds as they come down the front straightaway, right in front of this big, big crowd. Hanauer nose to nose with Reynolds, but will Reynolds duck inside him on that turn number one and maybe get that lead back? Boy, it's a neck and neck race right now. Scott Pierce, of course, well back in his Rolls-Royce Merlin powered boat in third place. It's a race between the two turbines of Hanauer and Reynolds, just neck and neck down the back straightaway. And what a great camera angle we've got here, Steve Evans.
Just fantastic, Brock, and that camera is mounted on the Coast Guard auxiliary boat, Zachary Taylor, and we thank them. On the inside is Steve Reynolds, suddenly poking his prow out in front is Chip Hanauer, the Miller American. Incredible side-by-side unlimited racing.
As we watch, 6,000 horsepower worth of unlimited hydroplane arrow underneath the bridge that connects the Indiana-Kentucky borders. That is Reynolds on the inside, heading down toward turn number four. Hanauer, way wide, gave up a little bit, but he'll probably get it back as they streak down the front straightaway.
And here we'll see the difference in 400 horsepower it can make. It is Chip Hanauer on the outside, the more powerful of the two turbines. Oh, and almost going airborne, Steve Reynolds in the Miss 7-Eleven. That is the most frightening thing that can happen to one of these drivers.
What they call a blowover. The air gets underneath the boat and wants to blow it right on its back. The worst part about it, Steve, is that you've got to apply more power to drive the bow down into the water, where the natural instinct is to lift to get the speed down. But a very, very difficult and a very harrowing moment for Steve Reynolds as they come off turn number two. It's still a neck and neck race down the back straightaway. And you'll notice that the river's starting to get a little bit of a chop on it. That, of course, is simply from the turbulence created by these two rocket-fast boats.
Well, Chip Hanauer now extending his lead, but he told me earlier this morning, Brock, there's so many ways to lose one of these races, so many things that can go wrong. You never get complacent, no matter how far out in front you might be.
Well, you are watching a boat streaking across the water at almost 200 miles an hour as he sweeps into turn number three and four. That is Hanauer. Look at this. Reynolds has crossed his wake, trying to get on the outside to find cleaner water. What a gutsy move by Steve Reynolds to jump the wake of Chip Hanauer coming off of turn four.
Incredible maneuver by Steve Reynolds. An awful lot of drivers would have been content, Rock, to just stay in that rough water on the inside and take their chances with it rather than crossing that wake, especially when the boat has already tried to blow over on him once.
Let's take another look at that as we watch Reynolds on the right side of your screen take a sharp left turn and just drive across the wake of Chip Hanauer. And you notice the boat got very, very weird as it hit that wake, and Reynolds manhandles it back under control and finds himself some cleaner water. So there is a gutsy man, Steve Reynolds, coming off of turn number two, riding in the second spot and doing everything he can to overtake a boat that has clearly more horsepower.
And here you can see why some of the drivers from Heat 1A said that the roughest water is on that backstretch. Look at the pounding that Steve Reynolds is taking, not to mention Chip Hanauer. Boy, these are a couple of hard notes. Something has gone wrong with that Miller American boat, Brock. The Miller American boat is slowing.
It sure is. He's lost power somehow, and he was on the last lap, headed for the checkered flag. Chip is waving to the officials to indicate that he isn't in any serious trouble. He's got no fire, no hole in the hull. Boat's not going to sink, but he's sure going to lose this heat because Steve Reynolds, and there he comes on the left side of your screen, is going to blow right past him to take the victory.
And when you fail to finish one of these heats, Brock, you get no points whatsoever. This could be disastrous for the Miller American team. There you see Hanauer, and Brock, I think he's checking the propeller.
Oh, it's entirely possible, Steve. There's a lot of driftwood in this river, which could have cleaned a blade off as we watch Steve Reynolds cross the line. What a gutty try he made to battle Hanauer in the early stages of this race. Fell back, of course, but now finds victory his as we watch poor Chip trying to figure out what brought that rapid boat, record-setting boat, as a matter of fact, to all here in the Ohio River.
And also giving Chip Hanauer a shower is Scott Pearson, the Executone boat. He will pick up second place and a lot of valuable points towards qualifying for the final race of the day, where all the money is and all the prestige. And it's interesting, you know, Brock, we talk about all these new hotshot turbines, but that is the national points leader right there through sheer consistency, the old tried and proven Executone.
And it may pay off for him yet again today as we see Steve Reynolds wins it, Scott Pearce second, and a very disappointed Chip Hanauer. No points, back in third place.
Usually on a pleasant weekend in historic Madison, Indiana, the town is swarming with tourists and antique shoppers, but today it's very quiet. That's because everybody went to the beach for the Budweiser Indiana Governor's Cup Regatta. I'm Steve Evans along with Brock Yates and Ed Bruce, and this is the bridge that connects Indiana and Kentucky. On one side of the beach, Brock, they're in Eastern time. On the other side, they're in Central time.
Well, I'll tell you what, they're just having a high old time here right now as we get a look at the winning boat of Steve Reynolds. And you don't think it's rough out there? Take a look at that windshield. Just chopped off, and it probably happened in that wake jumping adventure that Steve had when he was trying to get around Chip Hanauer. What a wild, wild ride for this young man, Steve Reynolds. Let's take one more look at those results, and let's not forget that Hanauer, because of his DNF, gets no points. He's the quick qualifier. That could be trouble for him. Let's go to Steve Evans.
Boy, deck to deck for a couple of laps, the people on the banks going crazy, and all of a sudden your power kind of went away.
See what they're going to do? They're going to take my hydroplane license away and give me an FAA certificate.
He was flying.
Yeah, it really was. But you've got to travel at those speeds and that conditions. You got to fly the boat. Sometimes it's out of control. You know, I was along for the ride.
Well, you welded them on the start.
Thank you. I mean, it was a good start. We had timed that earlier in the week, Stephen, and felt good.
But now what can Jerry Verhill and the crew do to the boat to improve that handling characteristic?
Well, the water conditions are so lumpy. I don't know that there's anything we can do. You know, you're going to fly over to pound through it, which is more damaging to your equipment. We'll talk about it. We'll analyze. We'll make the right decision.
One thing, it needs a new windshield.
Yeah, it needs a new one of those. Thank God it's a water sport.
Thank you. Steve Reynolds in great spirits. Who wouldn't be?
And Brock with the second place finisher, Scott Pearce.
Scott, what will you do now with the boat? Any problems to begin with that you resulted from the heat, or will you make some routine changes now?
Well, we're going to make some changes that we normally wouldn't make. The boat's getting a little light on its nose, and so we're going to try to quiet it down a bit, and the propeller wasn't working real well. And I think that's why I got left at the starting line, because I've been running with these guys all year long. But so we'll go to a different propeller and try to pick up some mile per hour.
Well, thanks, Scott, but I'll tell you what, your prop problems, nothing compared to this one. That's Chip Hanauer's propeller on the Miller American boat, and of course, that blade cleaned off there is what brought him to a halt as he was headed for victory. And that's Chip taking a look at the damage. Let's go down to Steve, who's with him.
Well, Chip, the crew on the dock long before you were towed in, suspicion to broken propeller or wheel, and that's what it is.
Yeah, unfortunately, like I said this morning, there's a million ways to lose, and a broken propeller is one of them.
A faulty wheel, debris in the water, what?
It's hard to tell. There is a lot of debris in the water. You know, what came first, the chicken or the egg, I don't know. But there is a lot of stuff in the water.
Well, a great deck-to-deck duel for a couple of laps there with Steve Reynolds.
Yeah, everything was kind of fun, you know, and Steve was running good and I was running good, and then I think he backed off, and I kind of have to run the same boat speed so my boat doesn't pound too bad, and the propeller let go.
You appeared to have by far the better handling boat of the two.
Yeah, it's hard to tell, you know. It's rough out there. In the corners, my boat was jumping around a bit. It's hard to tell what his boat was doing, but we were jumping around a bit.
Good luck next year. Go around.
Thanks. We're going to have to win now.
Well, it was broken piece of equipment, that very expensive, very exotic propeller blade you see right there, that has now put the pressure on Chip Hanauer, and that's Jim Lucero, the boat owner and probably the most advanced designer in this sport, taking a look at the damage.
And over in the 7-Eleven pits, Brock, they're adjusting the rear foil on that boat. I would guess taking a little pressure off, trying to get the nose down lower in the water. Right now, let's go to Ed with a special guest.
Thank you, Steve. This is Don Jones. Don is the commissioner of the Unlimited Division of the American Powerboat Association. Don, it's a fact. If a man can sit on it or sit in it, he's going to race it. Where are we with Unlimited Powerboats at this point?
Well, it looks like we're going faster and quicker around the corners, and so the speeds per lap are picking up dramatically. It's an exciting sport in those terms.
Where's powerboat racing going?
Well, we think we're on the move right now. We started a year ago with new race sites. It looks like we can add 5 new major cities next year. We'd like to bring our race circuit to 15. And that, of course, with new media awareness, attract new sponsors. And we think that that's the way to go.
On a good day, ideal conditions, normal course, what does an unlimited powerboat turn down the straits?
Well, they're going to go 190 miles an hour, and as you've just seen, a boat turning 140 on a lap. So it's very quick.
Thank you, Don. Appreciate your time. Thanks for talking to us. Let's go back to Brock and Steve.
Thanks, Ed and Don. And you can see a whole bunch of folks down by the riverside having a real good time here, waiting for yet more action in the river. It's calm right now, but the pits are full of activity. And believe me, we got a whole lot more to come.
Only 5 boats will qualify for the all-important final. And you can see here the 5th boat right now, points-wise, is Miss Madison at 225. It's going to be up to Chip Hanauer to bump that boat, or one of them at least, out of those top 5 positions if he's going to make any money or points today. Now, Heat 2A is coming up. Boats already going into the water. We'll be back with that action right after this. Stay with us from Madison, Indiana.
That's the Ohio River, you see. This is the Budweiser Indiana Governor's Cup for unlimited hydroplanes. You know, most of these boats come from Seattle, Washington area. That's kind of the Indianapolis of unlimited powerboat racing. But there's one boat that has a very strong local attachment. You're looking at her warming up right there.
You won't have any trouble finding the sentimental favorite here at the Governor's Cup Regatta, Miss Madison, owned by the 13,000 citizens of this historic riverside community. And you won't have any trouble spotting Miss Madison in the water either. She's the only conventional hydroplane left in the sport. That means the Allison engine is out in front of driver Skip Coker. Now, this old girl is no stranger to the winner's circle either. She was built in 1973, the original Pride of Pay and Pack boat. In fact, has won more heats than any boat here in the pit area today. Now, you say, how does a community afford its unlimited hydroplane habit? Well, there's a food stand up there by the Miss Madison Boosters. They have a golf tournament every year, dances, car washes. They'll take nickels and dimes from school kids. It doesn't matter. But what they all remember was an earlier Miss Madison in 1971 won the biggest unlimited hydroplane race of them all, the Gold Cup, right here on this river. They were dancing in the streets of Madison that night.
Well, who knows, Steve? Maybe they'll be dancing again tonight as we watch Coker getting ready to warm up for Heat 2A. He's up against Chip Hanauer, Todd Yarling, and Steve Reynolds. And remember the shootout that Hanauer and Reynolds had earlier in the going. And this time, though, Hanauer's got to win it.
Well, they've replaced that prop, obviously, on the Miller American boat. We saw him make some aerodynamic changes to the Miss 711. This could be another one of those great battles we saw in Heat 1B. Here they come down for the start. Look at the clock there as the seconds tick off. You can't cross that starting line with any time remaining. Now, that is Andy Coker and the Miss Madison out in front as they come down towards the starting line. On the inside comes the Miller American. On the outside comes the other turbine boat, Miss 711 and Steve Reynolds. They are going to blow right by Miss Madison. A beautiful start for Tim Hanauer. He cuts over in front of Miss Madison. That is Miss 711, Steve Reynolds on the outside. The positions just reversed from the first time they met.
It sure is, and as we heard earlier, Hanauer is pretty happy with the way that boat was handling, and he's got the tight inside line, so it's possible he's going to say so long to Steve Reynolds this time. It may not be the tight race that we had earlier, but look at that. As Hanauer pounds through that chop down the back straightaway, he loses Reynolds in that rooster tail. But you've got to be sure that Steve Reynolds is not going to lift under any circumstances. Hanauer, 190 miles an hour under the bridge here in the Ohio River, getting set up for turn number 3.
Well, not only is the extra horsepower in the Miller American a big speed advantage, Brock, but in this rough water, it helps out there too, just plowing through it.
But don't forget, he's the only man ever to lap this course at over 140 miles an hour. And there comes Reynolds swinging way wide, trying to get around, trying to get into that smooth water. Still riding in second spot. And he got a good shot off at turn number 4, Steve. It looks as if he might try to get by him as they come down to front 2.
Well, this duel between the two turbines is everything it was cracked up to be in the press going into this regatta. Just an incredibly exciting matchup.
And a wild sound, not the big hammering noise of an aircraft engine, but a kind of banshee shriek. As we see the two conventionally powered boats bringing up the rear, that's Andy Coker and Todd Yarling, both Allison-powered boats, a of course, Coker in the old conventional front engine boat, and Yarling in one of the newer cab over versions. But this one, boy, they don't come any quicker, no more sophisticated than that Hanauer boat, Steve.
And don't you know that back on the dock, there's a pretty lady with her fingers crossed, the co-owner of the Miller American, Fran Muncy, the widow of the great Bill Muncy, one of the finest drivers the Unlimited Sport has ever known. And she's mighty proud of this latest creation by Lucero, and mighty proud of her superstar driver, Chip Hanauer.
Well, of course, Chip took over the driving chores when Bill tragically lost his life in one of the earlier boats that came from the Muncy team. But now Hanauer, the number one driver for that team, heading apparently toward victory here. And that, of course, is a local favorite, Andy Coker, sitting high, riding high in that grand old boat, holding on right now to third place and doing a good job out there.
And you know, Brock, both of these drivers are handsomely paid to take the kind of punishment. Not Andy Coker. He doesn't make a dime for driving the Miss Madison. Remember, that's the community-sponsored boat. But he's happy to do it because it's his first unlimited ride. After years of success in 7-liter hydros, outboards, just about anything you can rocket across the water, and Andy's driven, except the unlimiteds. And this is a way of breaking into this tight fraternity, Brock.
Sure is. Most of these guys have a long background in boat racing of all types. You don't just jump into one of these things. It takes an enormous amount of experience, a lot of guts, and as you say, a touch to understand exactly how hard to ride these things before you get them completely out of the water.
And in the case of the Miss Madison boat, some upper body strength comes in handy.
Well, they used to all look like Miss Madison until guys like Lucero went to the what they call the cab over, the rear engine power plants, first with the big Rolls-Royce engines, and now with the turbines. And look at that thing skim across the water, just a bullet. One of the prettiest pieces of sporting equipment on Earth, Steve.
And there is the last lap flag, Brock. 2.5 miles separates Chip Hanauer from the points he so desperately needs if he's to qualify for the final. Even a win here does not necessarily guarantee him a final berth.
Yeah, it's going to be a real irony for the man to come in here and set this lap record, run away with both the heats he's been in, at least almost up until the DNF that first time out. But right now, he's just going to put it on Steve Reynolds as hard as he can to, if for no other reason, to establish himself as the quickest boat in the place. And I'm sure if lap times counted for anything, he'd get in right away. Todd Yarling, way back there, that boat has simply not been running that well. And look at how quickly Hanauer blew past Todd Yarling. That'll give you an idea of the differentials in speeds with some of these boats. And in a lot of cases, that's a question of hull, configuration, design, and of course, power. And power is what this man has. Over 3,000 horsepower.
And that is demonstrated, Brock, in that he has a two-turn lead over Steve Reynolds, who has just now come out of turn number two, holding down that second position. But he is a distant second.
Well, it may be that Reynolds has backed off a little bit, trying to keep that boat together. He doesn't want a DNF. He wants to get into that main event. As we see Hanauer blow past to take the victory and give himself 400 points, it may or may not be enough. But Reynolds, of course, by finishing second, picks up another 300 points, and that practically guarantees him a starting spot in the main event.
Oh, in fact, for sure. There'll be no keeping Steve Reynolds out of the main event if he can just take the checkered flag here, as Chip Hanauer already has. Now, Reynolds just making that turn out of four. And, Brock, if you look real close on the left-hand side of the boat, it looks like there's water coming up out of the sponson.
He may have hold the hull somehow, and, notice that water just squirting out just be in front of his head. These hulls are a very sophisticated mix of fiberglass and marine plywood, and it could be that he hit something, perhaps to rupture, or maybe just a hard ride Steve's given him could have caused a rupture somewhere in that hull sponson.
Well, they'll have time to repair it before the final, Brock. He has taken second place. The checkered flag is waved, but Todd Yarling from Hanover, Indiana, the Cellular One boat, is suddenly dead in the water.
Yeah, he's taking a peek inside there to try to figure out what broke, and he is obviously displeased with whatever happened. Shakes his fist, disappointment all over the place for Todd Yarling. He hasn't been running that well all day, so it's been a hard time for him so far. Here comes the local favorite, Andy Coker, riding into third place. And you know, Steve, it's possible that he also could get into the feature.
And with a little bit of luck, Who knows? As fragile as these turbine boats have been today, he could just win it. So here's the final results of Heat 2A. Hanauer, Reynolds, Coker, Yarling in that order. Stay with us for more Unlimiteds. Outside of Madison, Indiana, lies the 1,360-acre Clifty Falls State Park. With its deeply cut gorges, sheer rock walls, and plunging waterfalls, Clifty Falls gives witness to the awesome powers at work in nature. Clifty Falls and its canyon are a subsequent erosion feature of the Ice Age. From the lip of Clifty Falls at an elevation near the general level of the county, Clifty Creek plunges more than 70 feet. But today, Madison, Indiana is into the speed age. It's the Budweiser Indiana Governor's Cup Unlimited Hydroplane Race here on the Ohio River. I'm Steve Evans, along with Brock Yates and Ed Bruce. And here's the point standings from Heat 2A. Miller American Boat with 400 points, and even that 400 points do not guarantee them a spot in the final today. Brock Yates is down in the pits with the boat's co-owner and designer, Jim Lucero.
Bring me up to date on exactly what the status of Chip getting into the final is right now. He just won that heat, but of course broke the prop in the first heat. So what has to transpire for him to get into the final now?
Of course, not finishing the first heat cost us 400 points. We did pick up 400 points for winning the second heat, but I think the other boats right now have enough points to keep us out of the final at this point, depending on what happens in the second section of the second heat. Right now, I think that we're in the position of being the first alternate for the final if everybody finishes the second heat. You never know what's going to happen. You know, we've had times when we haven't started, and so hopefully Lady Luck will shine on us for the final.
Thanks, Jim. We hope it works out because we'd like to see a shootout between the three fastest boats on the river. Chip's boat, this boat, the Miss Budweiser, and, of course, the 7-Eleven Turbine, which you remember sustained some damage. Steve is down there to have a look at that boat.
There's a little bit of the Ohio River raining down on the trailer of Steve Reynolds' U-7. You can see why here. There's a giant separation in the sponson. Now, some of this damage was inflicted last week in Detroit. The remainder of it was in Heat 2A. You'll recall that Reynolds was running the boat very easy. The sponson down in the water, pounding against the chop. So that actually did more damage than running the boat hard. You can bet in the final. They're not going to fix this, by the way. Just leave it alone, let the water drain out. But you can bet in the final that this part of the boat probably won't even be hitting the water as hard as Steve Reynolds is going to be on the gas.
Well, that little salute cannon, traditional part of yacht racing, be it sailboats or powerboats, as it signals 5 minutes to go before the start of the next heat.
And the first boat out into the water to warm up is Jerry Hopp and the Old Boy Oberto boat. And you saw him in the very first heat of today's action run very consistently, a fine driver and a nice machine. Earlier, Brock had a chance to take a look at a very important piece of equipment on this boat.
As we said before, these boats are part airplane, part watercraft. Very little of them is actually in the water at speed, but what is in the water is the rudder back here, which is a pretty conventional rudder, as you'll find out on almost any boat, with two exceptions. One, this little water pickup down here. All the cooling water for the engine follows up through this hose, and there's a water pump that picks that up, but its pickup is right here on the forward edge of the rudder. There's also a water speed indicator, which will tell the driver roughly how fast he's going, although it also has an airspeed indicator on board to tell him a really accurate figure. So that is the controlling mechanism for steering the boat. But there is another component on board an unlimited hydroplane that also helps in the steering. Come on up here and I'll show you. This is what we call the skid fin. It's always on the port side or the left side of an unlimited hydroplane, and it rides in the water about this far down into the water, and it creates a drag on the boat as the driver turns into the left-hand corners. Remember, these are always left-handed courses, just like Indianapolis cars and whatever. So when the driver turns left, this skid fin digs in and turns and hooks the boat into the corner. So it assists in the steering and, believe it or not, doesn't interfere with the stability as the boat runs down the straightaway.
And here is Jerry Hopp continuing to warm up as the second ticks away towards the start of Heat 2A. Also out there, and of course, a boat a lot of the fans will be watching, is Jim Cropfield, just now leaving the dock in this Budweiser. And remember, that's a fresh power plant that was installed between heat races in the Bud boat. Now, the most interested spectator of them all will be Chip Hanauer. Not so much to see who wins, he's just hoping that one of the boats doesn't finish and opens the door for a final round berth for the Miller American. Stay with us from Madison, Indiana.
it is. Jim Kropfeldt and the Budweiser, Scott Pierce and the U8 and Jerry Hupp. All three of these boats powered by different engines. Kropfeldt, their legendary Rolls-Royce Griffin. Pierce, Rolls-Royce Merlin, a little bit less horsepower. And Hupp, turbocharged Allison. All three aircraft engines, Steve.
Now that is Scott Pierce, the executive boat on the inside. In the middle is the old boy, Oberto, Jerry Hupp. On the outside, making a drive for the start is Jim Kropfeldt and the Miss Budweiser, and Rocky nailed the start perfectly.
Beautiful, running absolutely flat out, nailed the start, and sweeps into turn number one. Way wide though, but look at, here comes Scott Pierce down low, right up against the buoys. They call them pins in unlimited hydroplane racing. Tucked in right against that pin, and he'll come off of turn number two in the lead.
Now, we have not seen Kropfeldt take an inside line all day. The heavier boat just doesn't want to turn that sharply.
Nope. So Scott Pierce comes off the corner with a little bit of a lead. Scott Pierce, remember, was going to change his prop and hope for a little more top speed, and it looked like that conversion worked out for him because Scott's running strong right now.
Scott Pierce, the leader in the National Points Championship, showing you why right now. It's just a consistent old horse. It doesn't break down very often, and he's accumulated a lot of points for that reason, as the turbines, even though on paper they're very reliable, they're really in their infancy. They have not worked all the bugs out of them. Here comes Kropfeldt.
Kropfeldt way wide, coming off of turn four. That big Griffin motor, a whole bunch more cubic inches than the Merlin that Scott Pierce has, but Pierce has the inside line and still holds on to the lead as they head back under the bridge.
And don't you know, Brock, that Kropfeldt is all over the nitrous button coming out of those turns.
You can be sure of that. But I'll tell you what, Jim Lucero and Chip Hanauer and Fran Muncy and the rest of the Miller American crew, they probably aren't watching this race so much as they are Jerry Hobb back there in third place, because his boat's not running very well. And they're probably saying, well, Jerry, why don't you just park it? And that'll let us get into the main event.
You don't think Jerry's about to do that, do you?
No, I doubt it. Look at this race. Sideways, power sliding through the corners. Kropfeldt ducks down in low now. Looks like he may try to get in a little bit tighter in that corner. Maybe even jump the wake of Scott Pierce to get on the inside. But now they come down the back straight through that chop, headed toward the bridge, neck and neck. Good, good, unlimited powerboat race.
And as they head for turn number three, Brock, it's that skid fin that you showed us on Jerry Hobbs' boat that enables these machines to corner like they do. Without that skid fin, they just slide right up to the beach.
Well, here comes Scott Pierce. Kropfeldt got a little bit of a lead on him, but as they head into turn number three, it's Pierce that's going to dive down underneath them and perhaps hold that lead. Jim Kropfeldt just counting on the raw power of that big Griffin to just yank him off the corners, as you say, with a little bit of a help from the nitrous button. And who's to know? But look at this. Pierce gets himself about three boat lengths coming off of turn four. He is going to hold that lead. He may win this thing.
Indeed, he might. Look at this. Miss Butt on the outside. Scott Pierce on the inside, and it's that inside line that has paid off for him so far.
Well, these boats are so hairy, so difficult to control. You just can't get too close to each other. You said that earlier. You can't bounce them off, and we've only seen one wake cross here today. That was a real gutsy move by Steve Reynolds. But it looks as if Kropfeldt is going to stay on the outside and just count on that extra power. He has it to pull off this race.
We talked about nitrous oxide earlier. That is laughing gas, the same thing that your dentist might give you to make an extraction a little more pleasant, a little more palatable. The same stuff. It's a pressurized gas. You just push a button, it's worth 400 or 500 horsepower.
Well, Kropfeldt looks as if he's pulled out a little bit of a lead. He got in tight coming off of turn two, and that might give him a little bit of the advantage that he needs. But remember now, it's been Pierce that has run real well through turn three and four and has managed to hold on to that lead down the front straightaway. And look at that beautiful shot. You get an idea of what a beamy kind of boat these Unlimiteds are. Very, very wide boats. But don't forget, look at that. Scott Pierce sideways just slides that boat in tight to hold onto that lead. What a shot, Steve.
And did you notice how early he turns that boat? Before you think he really would, he sets it up and slides it much like you would a dirt track car.
Yep. Just kind of 3,000 horsepower sprint cars out here on the water. Kropfeldt can't seem to quite get by Scott Pierce. Boy, Scott wanted some more power. He sure got it.
Well, whatever changes they made to that boat, propeller and whatever, have paid off here. The boat is much faster than it was in the earlier heat.
It sure is. And look at how clean that rooster tail is for Scott Pierce's boat. You can, of course, the guys that run these boats all the time can read these boats, the way the rooster tail looks, the way the boat rides on the water. And I'm sure Scott Pierce's crew is really happy with the way that boat's running right now. Scott comes from a long boat racing heritage. His dad owned Unlimited. Scott, 30 years old, made a big reputation in the smaller 5-liter hydros before moving to the Unlimited, and it has a real future. A very gutty, very heady driver.
Well, here is Jerry Hopp. Speaking of guts, this man could get the job done. The old boy, Alberto, boat. U4 currently in the third spot, and right now all he wants to do is finish. He doesn't care if he's 2 miles behind. This man doesn't want him to finish. Nothing personal, but Chip Hanauer would like a shot at the final. He's not going to get it if all three of these boats take the checkered flag.
And right now, Steve, all of them are running like watches, in particular this one, the Rolls-Royce Merlin-powered Executone boat of Scott Pierce. By the way, that is a Jim Lucero hull, brand new hull last year, so it's essentially a very contemporary hull with a very strong engine in it.
And here is Scott headed down for the checkered flag. This is the last few yards of the last lap, and it appears that Scott Pierce, the Executone telephone boat, is going to take the checkered flag in Heat 2B. Indeed, he does. Now, will the other two boats make it to that finish line? If they do, you know the story. Hanauer will be a spectator for the final.
Right you are, Steve, and his chances are rapidly diminishing as we watch Jim Kropfeldt race across the line to take second place. That leaves only Jerry Hopp out on the river. Kropfeldt, of course, the defending champion. He'll move into the feature race with that big Griffin-powered boat that he's got. So it's going to be certainly Reynolds and Kropfeldt among the two heavy hitters, and it may or may not be Hanauer. That question is, will Jerry Hopp come across the line? If he does, and it looks like he will, that is goodbye, Chip.
You know, I said that Hanauer would be on the beach for the final. That's not entirely true. The rules allow them to put that boat in the water for the full 5 minutes in case during the warm-ups anybody has problems. He can fill that slot. So you can bet the Lucero, Fran Muncy, and crew will do that.
They sure will, because they are pure professional racers and among the very best in the business. And here comes Jerry Hopp to come across the line to take the third spot in that heat. So we've got final results here in Heat 2B. Scott Pierce, good strong win. Kropfeldt second, Jerry Hopp third.
But I tell you what, in the final coming up, they'll all be after Scott Pierce, trying to erode that points lead he has for the national championship. Right now, let's again go to Ed Bruce.
Thanks. This is Dave Rue. Dave is the president of the Madison Regatta. And really, Madison kind of occupies a unique place in powerboat racing, a town of 13,000 people. And yet it's one of the more prestigious competing with mega population racing centers. How do you account for it?
Well, Ed, this will be the 34th Indiana Governor's Cup ran here in Madison. We've been racing unlimited hydroplanes for approximately 36, 37 years. It is unique. Again, the population, 13,000, we get the total support of the community. And that is, we are an all-volunteer organization, and that's the key.
Dave, thanks for taking the time to talk to us.
Thank you.
Let's go back to Brock and Steve.
Right, Ed, and here's the man who won the last heat, Scott Pierce. Steve's with him.
Good job, Scott. And that's one thing you had to do, really, was to make the final, try to keep that point lead alive, huh?
Well, we could have finished second and made the final. We could have finished third and made the final. But what we did do is pick up another 100 points on the Budweiser for the national, the world championship. And that was important to Executone to do that.
Water conditions now compared to earlier today.
It's pretty bad. I'm going to tell you, there's some lumpers out there that you can't believe, but we're tough. We'll go through it. No problem.
You've got the consistency, that's for sure, and a very enthusiastic crew.
Yes, this is our whole Executone crew, and they're really behind us, and we're having a good year, and it's nice when you have a good year.
Good luck in the final.
Thank you, Steve.
And what a final it's going to be, Steve. We've got the heavy hitters here with one exception, of course, as we get a beautiful look of Madison, Indiana. Okay, the lineup. Miss Executone, Miss Budweiser, Miss 7-Eleven, the turbine boat, Old Boy Alberto, and the local favorite, Miss Madison. Stay with us for the finals here at the Indiana Governor's Cup.